This lecture will review parenteral medications. In this part two, we will review injections. Parenteral medications include injections, and that's intradermal, intramuscular, subcutaneous, and intravenous. Okay, first, let's look at a syringe. So a syringe has three parts. The tip holds the needle, the barrel is the outside part where the calibrations for measurements are located, and the plunger is the inner portion that fits into the barrel and moves the medication. The types of syringes are TB syringes, insulin syringes, and what I'll call standard syringes. A standard syringe is calibrated in mLs or milliliters. They come in 1, 3, 5 mLs, but also in 10, 20, 50, and 60 mLs. The TB syringe only holds 1 ml, which allows for very small amounts to be used correctly. An insulin syringe is calibrated in units and always has an orange cap on it. Insulin syringes should never be used for anything other than insulin. We will choose a syringe based on the amount and the calibrations needed for a medication. Syringes are considered sterile until opened from the package. As we prepare to give an injection, we must consider the length and the gauge of a needle. Injection needles usually come from 3/8 to 1.5 inches is our standard sizes. For intramuscular injections, we usually use a 1 to 1.5 inch. Subcutaneous, we usually use a 3/8 to a 5/8. And for intradermal, we usually use a 1/4 to 1/2 inch needle. The gauge of a needle refers to the diameter of the hole through the needle. The higher the gauge, the smaller the hole. When we choose a needle gauge, it is based on the site of injection and the viscosity of the fluid that's being given. An intradermal would use a high gauge or a very fine needle with a small hole. An intramuscular injection will require a thicker needle or a lower gauge needle, like a 20 to 23. Safety must always be considered when giving injections. Safety devices are frequently attached to our needles because the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, or OSHA, requires that employers protect employees from accidental needle sticks. All needle sticks can result in the transfer of blood-borne pathogens from the patient to the individual giving the injection, so you never want to recap a needle. But if you do, you want to use the scoop method, where you put the cap on a flat surface and then you scoop it up. The safest way to dispose of used needles is to immediately put them into a disposable sharps container to reduce the risk of needle sticks, cuts, and punctures from the needle. The intramuscular route for medications provides a quick absorption of medication because of the plentiful blood supply to the muscles. This route is commonly used for antibiotics and immunizations. For administration, the skin is usually held taut and is given at a 90-degree angle. You must always aspirate, which means to pull back the plunger before injecting the medication, to check for accidental placement into a blood vessel. You'll get a blood return if you pull back, if you're into a blood vessel. If you see blood when you aspirate, you must not give the medication. You need to take the needle out, throw out the medication, and start again. IM injections go through the dermis and the subcutaneous tissue into the muscle layer. Sites for injection are the deltoid in the upper arm. The ventral gluteal site is safe for patients older than 2 years old. To find this site, you place the heel of your hand on the greater trochanter, there on the hip, and the index finger on the anterior iliac spine. You spread your middle finger as far back as possible and then give the injection between those two fingers. The vastus lateralis is located on the anterior lateral thigh, away from the nerves and blood vessels, which is the site of choice for infants and small children. The dorsal gluteal is in the buttocks. This site is really discouraged these days because of the possible damage to the sciatic nerve. Subcutaneous injections are administered into the subcutaneous fatty tissue. This route is used for medications requiring a slower absorption than an IM injection, such as insulin and medications like heparin. Insulin is always given subcutaneous. With subcutaneous injections, you bunch up the skin and you give it at a 45-degree angle. Because subcutaneous tissue has a few blood vessels, you don't need to aspirate. Common sites for subcutaneous injection are the anterior thighs, the abdomen, and the upper arms. Less common is the upper back and the buttocks. You know, if an individual is getting daily injections, it's really important that they rotate those injection sites. The intradermal injection is given just below the epidermis into the dermis. It is used for TB or allergy testing. TB tests may be called PPDs because the tuberculin solution is purified protein derivative, an extract of Mycobacterium tuberculosis, the bacteria that causes tuberculosis in humans. So for an intradermal injection, the needle is inserted at a 10 to 15 degree angle. You do not aspirate and you slowly inject the medication, forming a wheel, which is a slight elevation in the skin. The forearm is used for PPDs. Medication is given IV. It is given directly into the bloodstream. This is the fastest route of medication and it skips the absorption step. IV fluids and many types of medications are administered via this route. The IV route is especially used in emergencies so that we have a rapid, almost immediate onset of medications. You know, states have different laws about who can start IV infusions. There are three major types of fluids that are given IV. A dextrose solution is a sugar and water solution. If sugar is not needed, a saline solution may be prescribed. Or a lactated ringer solution is a mixed solution of dextrose, potassium, sodium, lactate, and calcium. So here's a picture of an IV setup. You see the IV solution bag, and then there's a spike where the tubing goes into the bag. There's an injection port to the left there where medications can be injected to the bag. Then there's the drip chamber, the flow regulator clamp, then tubing. If you look towards the end, there's a filter, and then there's the IV catheter that goes into the patient's vein. There's also midway, you'll see that an IV piggyback is hooked into that, and that allows for a secondary medication to be given to the patient. That concludes part two of parenteral medications. Any questions? Let me know. Bring them to class. Bring them to the farm cafe.